Hey, let's just start off with a real warm welcome for Jen Caserta. You've all braved the rain, thank you. Yes, we arranged the rain so that when we talk about Portlandia, we feel like, you know, we're there. So as many of you know, in 2010, IFC, led by Jen Caserta, transitioned in two ways. One, from being a sponsorship-based model to an ad-supported network with full public ratings, and then creatively shifting from an indie film channel to being driven by original comedy that embodies the always-on, slightly-off tagline and mission. The network is now in more than 73 million homes, having gained more than 10 million since that time in fourth quarter of 2010, and it's more than doubled its original programming as well. So we're gonna talk a lot about that. But I wanna start off, Jen, so in your career, you've relaunched and rebranded a lot of things, a lot of different parts of the business. But based on that and based on everything else that you know, what made you think, yeah, let's make these two big changes and let's do it all at the same time? Why did you think that would work?
Because we wanted to drive everybody crazy, and why not? Just do everything, change it all, make yourselves nuts. It's funny because, you know, I was at IFC for a little while before we actually made the switch, and it was something I was always really wanting to do, but I guess the time needed to be right. And we were, you know, we had a reputation, we had this credibility for being cool, and people certainly had an affinity for the brand, but you know, we were just kind of all over the place. You know, we were an indie film channel, we did some documentaries, we did some original series, and while everything that we did was very interesting, nothing really accrued to one very focused position. So that needed to happen. You know, if we were going to exist and thrive and be successful, that needed to happen. And at the time, there was this emergence of smart, interesting comedy that now you see a lot more of, obviously, today. But it was emerging. It wasn't always, there weren't always homes for it. We thought we could be a home for it. We dabbled in a little bit, and it started to work. And then, of course, in order to enable ourselves to do the transition successfully, we needed to make changes in our business model. And we were a sponsorship-driven network. We actually did sponsorship and integration very well, but we had a handful of advertisers. I could count them all. Now we have over 200. So we decided to make this switch to enable us to make the change and invest in what was really important, and that was original programming. You know, indie film was not, while great respect for it, and that was the legacy of the brand, that was not going to carry us into the future of television programming.
So what were your expectations in terms of time frame, markers for success, you know, for the first 4 years, I guess, and where are you? Are you about where you thought you'd be? Are you a little behind? Are you a little ahead?
In terms of perception, I think we gained traction relatively quickly. To think, you know, in 4 years' time, we have, you know, shows that are very recognizable, that are, you know, people can attribute to being on IFC, and IFC can be credited with being a comedy channel. You know, those types of transitions don't happen overnight, particularly for a brand that had been around for 16 years before we made the transition. So I'm actually quite pleased with how quickly audiences, you know, gravitated to what the new IFC would be, which, you know, I think we made the right decision, being that worked so well.
You've been on the air 16 years.
Yeah, we've been on the air 16 years when we decided to make the switch. So to go from an independent film channel to a destination for smart original programming and being known for your original programming, getting Emmy nominations, WGA nominations and awards for that programming, I think 4 years is not so bad. You know, we had a 5-year plan, and you know, we are on track. Do I always wish there was more original programming on the network? Did that not accelerate as quickly as I would like? Yeah, probably, but you know, we have even, you know, double what we have on the air in 2014 happening in 2015. You know, we do more programming than we had imagined, so that's just my own impatience. So I'm not the most patient person.
So what was there an aha moment, or what was the genesis of Always On, Slightly Off? Where did that come from? What's the story of that?
As a marketer in my heart and soul, and that was, you know, the background that I had, a television marketer, I always tend to, I can't help myself, look for either the possibilities or the things that are terrific about brands. You know, what do we want to enhance about a brand that you love, and then what do you want to change about a brand to make more people adore it? There was always something about IFC that actually was quite difficult to articulate. And again, I think it was because we were not so focused as we were when we decided we were going to definitively be this comedy brand and speak to a certain kind of comedy. I knew that we were interesting, that we were different, that people liked what we were doing. We had a distinct point of view. The indie perspective was something that we could really hang our hat on. We could transition and move from independent film to, an indie perspective, and people who typically liked that kind of content were interesting, different people who carried that over into their other likes and passions. So, you know, their music, the art that they liked, their sensibility, the music they listened to. That was really the springboard. But saying it actually was not as easy as it might seem. You know, it's like, I can't put the tagline, shit you can't find anywhere else on the network. That's not gonna fly. That's like, but it's like, that's what I wanted
watch
to
that,
say.
Though. I would.
Yeah, a lot of people, I would watch that, but I don't, you know, try to get, selling it in might be a little bit more challenging.
Was that the sort of working tagline, shit you can't find?
Yeah, shit you can't find anywhere else, now run with it. So, you know, but that, it was that, you know, it was that sentiment, but how can we say that succinct, clean, and something that everybody would get. So there was a lot of work that was put in. We knew what we wanted to say ultimately, but what were we going to say? What were the words? And there was a lot of work put into the creative briefs and who we were going to work with and what exactly we wanted the ultimate goal to be.
Yeah.
And all the things that I had just discussed, many, many meetings, many conversations. And I remember being in the room when, you know, being taken through kind of the you know, here are the five ways we can go with what we've been working on. It was like three taglines and presentations in. We're always on, slightly off, hit the conference room table. And I was like, that's it, stop, no more. And the people I were working with were very dedicated. People were working on this a long time in the marketing team. And they were like, but there's more to show. I said, stop, do not go past this moment. This is it, it's perfect.
Wow.
You know, it just, it's very rare that you. It's very rare that you come across something that you know is so right, and maybe I haven't come across people who are going to challenge it, but I've yet to come across somebody who says, "I hate your tagline. I don't get it, and it doesn't fit well with your brand." You know, people tend to kind of fall in love with it. So, we've been wearing it proudly since.
It's a great story. So let's talk about the transition on the business side.
Mm-hmm.
So, like you said, you did the sponsorship, branded, brand-funded content, or branded content, really, mm-hmm. really, really well. And then you're moving to bring more advertisers, sell actual spots, be rated.
Yep.
But you're still doing the sponsors,
mm-hmm.
sponsored stuff. And I think we have a clip of an example of that from last season, the Portlandia. NPR tailgating clips.
Yes.
Would you mind setting that
up?
Yeah,
sure. We've been actually working with Subaru since season one of Portlandia. And,
so were they one of the 10 that you could,
They actually were a new advertiser to the network.
Okay.
And they've been integrating and have been involved with the show. Last season, we integrated them into this particular sketch, which I think you get a good example of integration not getting in the way of content and sensibility. And I think the clip also does a really good job of kind of, you know, nailing what the show is about at its heart. We take the rowdiest, you know, moment in people's lives and turn it into a Portlandia sketch. That is what tailgating looks like in Portlandia.
What are the conversations like with advertisers? Can you characterize, you know, what the process is with
this as an example?
You know, what's interesting is that, you know, the advertisers, you don't necessarily have to be humorous in terms of the way that they present their brands and they're creative, and there's actually more of a willingness than you would think to be funny, you know, to kind of live in a world of comedy. You would think that most brand managers, clients are very protective of their brands. They wouldn't dare, you know, be in a place where there would be, you know, there'd be laughter around it. And they're so precious, precious and protective. And we've actually had the opposite experience. I think because we did branded integration so well for many years, there was a trust level that was built. We were able to show examples of how we treat brands. And then, of course, with a show like Portlandia, you have, you know, you have advertisers who are very willing to kind of let the creative of the show take them to a place. Okay. So it's a lot of fun. I mean, we've done song parodies about Cheez-Its. We've done a lot of interesting things.
Well, you kind of think of a Subaru as being a Pacific Northwest.
Ah, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, that's,
if you're gonna tailgate at an NPR event, you're going to do it in a Subaru.
Sticking with Portlandia, I mean, that's really been a shining example for you guys, right? So the fifth season comes up in January, and I'm wondering, you know, as far as ratings expectations, typically the fifth season is not, you know, earlier on is where you start to see, you know, things really take off from a ratings perspective, but you have had an incredible embrace from pop culture and the ether. You know, it's out there. What are your expectations, your hopes for converting all of that goodwill into ratings points and things that you can do to make money?
I mean, you know, we look at success in aggregate. You know, we're a smaller network. People watch our network in different ways. Sometimes, you know, time shifting is important, but we do have to look at, as a whole, what does this show do for us? And Portlandia is our best example of, it's got critical acclaim, award status. It's, you know, our highest rated show, most successful show on the network, and the ratings have steadily climbed over the years. And then being a part of the cultural conversation is, I mean, that's a big deal to be off season and still hear and see
spoofs online,
everything, and, spoofs online and mentioned in articles that aren't just about television and television shows. It's about travel, it's about cookbooks, it's about chicken, it's about, I mean, you know, it's birds. Portlandia is referenced as part of the you know, kind of the catchphrases that are used. So it has being part of the cultural conversation and creating that sense of urgency, I think helps lift the show.
Do you expect in this coming season to see them continue to grow? I mean,
that's the expectation. Obviously, we're always looking for, you know, we're always looking for audience build. That's for sure. But again, we do have to look at it. You know, where is Portlandia watched? You know, who's talking about it? There are different measurements of success, and the fact that, you know, 5 years later, it is still talked about as often as it is, and recognized the way that it's recognized and has such popularity and a fan base is all good.
Excellent. Well, I know maybe about a month ago you released the trailer.
Yes, we had a clip that we released for season 5. It premieres January 8th. At 10 o'clock, set your DVRs, watch it live. And we just did a sneak peek of
a
clip.
Got that, yeah. So let's check out the Portlandia goth clip.
I'm not giving away part of the sketch, but because it's something that you wouldn't see up close, except if you were, if you would see it up close, but there's like a tip sheet later on giving some background on these people, and it says alias, and it has things like alias, also known as Prince of Darkness, Depths of Hell, you know, it's just very
So I'm going to want to talk about some of the other programming on the network, but let's talk about your sense of humor first. So I personally found that very funny. I think a lot of us in here did. How much of the personality of the network reflects your own sense of humor?
I mean, you know, we're not programming to me. I would be awfully nice if that were the case, but I'm very fortunate because I have worked at other networks where, you know, it's just the programming is not for me. That wasn't my job, though. It was to cater to people who are going to actually watch the yeah. shows designed for the audiences of that network. I do feel incredibly fortunate because I love comedy. I love to laugh. I've always loved it. So, you know, it's rare that you have a job that you actually would be and are a consumer of the content. But yeah, I mean, I've always liked irreverent and interesting comedy from when I was a kid. I was staying up and watching SNL when it launched, and at an incredibly inappropriate age, you know, sneaking in to see, you know, my first R-rated movie was Animal House, which, you know, is great. Movies like Foul Play, and, you know, just, yeah. you know, it's just like, it's something that I always loved, you know, watching soap when it was on. So then that was like so boundary pushing for right. for that time, both in its subject matter and its character and what it was tackling. So yeah, it's great to be able to watch the shows and see shows being developed that I personally would watch and love. But I know it's rare.
What's what's one slightly off thing about you?
I have a lot of people in the audience who would give you a laundry list, but I've always been a bit unconventional. You know, I present myself as slightly normal, but I've always had, you know, it's just interesting things about me. Growing up, I was a ballet dancer and performing artist, and you know, but I loved heavy metal, so I'd be going to Metallica concerts at night and then performing, you know, the Nutcracker the next day, which is always kind of weird. It's a really weird dynamic.
At the same time, we were talking about this earlier, really not that far apart, because to be a ballerina, you got to be pretty badass. Right?
You got to be badass, yeah, absolutely. It's not, you know, so I think there are things about me that are always, you know, my husband's a stay-at-home dad, and, you know, it's just always a little more unconventional.
Nice. So let's talk about where you find the talent for the network. You know, it can come from all places. There's a long history in programming comedy. People, you know, going to comedy clubs. Mm-hmm. I imagine there's still some of that, right? But where else are you finding the stars?
Finding talent. Yeah. I have a whole group of talented people there over there who that's their job. It's actually what they do is find and discover and build new shows. But, you know, I think we have an advantage now that we have gained some traction in the space. So initially when you're changing your brand and, you know, now going out and you know, you're pitching yourself. Yeah. Come to me with your projects, please. We're a destination for comedy. Believe it or not, we're not an indie film channel anymore. Then when you start putting the things that we put on the air, people get a really good sense of what kind of shows we're looking to produce and build, and we have the opportunity for people to come to us. But, you know, the outlets, there's relationships, which is certainly a big part of it, which is yeah. what our original programming team uses a great deal. They have great relationships with great talent and interesting, funny people. But, you know, there's just so many places where you can discover and see people, you know, doing their craft. So, of course, there's the digital space and podcasts and, you know, just other, there are other places, books and, you know, all kinds of premise.
Do you think more equals easier to find people? Like, now that there's more places to go to find talent, that makes it easier? Or is it just like, oh, where do I go?
No, I think, you know, choice is always good. And you do have, you know, people have the ability to see people in action, which yeah. I think is interesting. You know, Portlandia wasn't just a pitch at a conference room table, they actually said, oh, we made some videos, because everybody can do that now. Mm. You can listen to a podcast like Comedy Bang Bang and say, what would that be like if that were a television show? How would it play out? Or know Marc Maron's craft, because you know, you're familiar with his podcast and how it's resurrected his career. So I think choice is good. Not everything's, choice is good, not all of the choices are good.
Right.
So, you know, that's what the professionals try to weed out and find some gems.
Well, podcasts is interesting. It sort of seems lately everyone's like, oh my gosh, podcasts, because Serial has had this phenomenal success. Obviously
it's
not
like
a comedy,
we're back
but
to like the beginning of radio, where people are, you know, around, huddled around listening. It's hysterical. I love it.
Yeah. That said, how did Maron come about and play into the format that you ended up doing?
Yeah, I mean, we were always big fans of Mark's. He's, you know, he's been around for a long time. He's got such a distinct voice when it comes to comedy, but certainly the podcast, you know, he did, it did resurrect his career. He got this, you know, this newfound fan base as a result of it. So we had this great appreciation for him. We produced the show in partnership with Fox Television, and you know, it's loosely based on Mark's life. It's a scripted narrative series, but the podcast does play. That's the constant, and that plays a role. And in a sense, it's a workplace comedy, because that's what Mark does for a living. He sits in his garage and he interviews very, very accomplished people in the world of comedy, acting, music, and just because he walks from his house and he goes into his garage and he sits down, he's at work. And then other things happen around him about his relationships and things that occur that are just funny about his life. So there's an example of the podcast not being the central theme of the show, but it's a character.
Part of the setting,
yeah.
So we do have a clip from that.
We do. This is from last season, season two. We're actually currently producing season three, where David Cross is his podcast guest and helps him deal with some family issues.
Love his face.
I want to invite David over to help me out with my family. Just get them all stoned and work it out, will ya?
We have a family conference.
Yeah.
New code word. Great stuff. So you mentioned this is produced in partnership with Fox, mm-hmm. right? So there is a big push throughout the industry, a lot of companies that have cable networks looking to own as much of their content as possible.
Yeah.
Where are you guys on that?
I mean,
how much do you want to?
We want to own our content, and we strive to, and we own many of our shows, but then there are some. We're not going to turn down a project just because it has, you know, a studio attached to it or a partner attached to it. So it really is a mix. And I think there was a studio network relationship of the past that I think is now become more flexible, where both sides have found benefit to doing partnerships like this. It's reciprocal.
Yeah.
It's not so one-sided. I would say the producing partners that we work with, we see that. And then there's also, you know, when there's a great IP that an intellectual property that you want to work with, like a Spoils of Babylon, that Funny or Die and their brand had created and brought to us because they thought we would be the right producing partner. We're not going to say, oh, no, mm-hmm. you know. You own that product, and we're not going to work in conjunction with you. It's actually been a terrific partnership, and there's great benefit to saying, you know, this is from Will Ferrell and Funny or Die. So anyway, we want to own as much as we can. That is what we strive to do. But you know, it's really about what's going to work, and working on it together.
So speaking of Funny or Die, and you also have had the Onion News Network show as well.
Mm-hmm.
Both of those are up for sale. Is that something, when that happens, you hear that they're on the block, do you go to Ed Carroll and Josh Zapan and say, guys, we should be looking at this?
We should buy that. You know, it's I think, well, I love those brands, and I think it's so interesting. You know, we're a television entity, and I think that it's very interesting to see what's happening with digital properties as they get folded into other media companies and the valuation of those media companies. So, you know, I love working with them, and I think that they're great partners. But and it's fun to throw those ideas out. They certainly are always open to ideas, and it's nice to kind of say, you know, what? Imagine if we owned this.
I'm gonna put you on the spot. Are you guys talking about that at all?
No. I mean, no. You know, we talk about, there are often times where we'll have, you know, just interesting conversations or brainstorms and say, if you could have one thing, what would it be? And they're always just, you know, kind of big ideas, but no, there's no talk of that.
If you could have one thing, what would it be right now? For 2015, like?
Well, for 2015, I think, you know, what I desire is, you know, we work with great talent. We have a very impressive roster of big names, comedy names, and people who aren't specifically in the comedy space on our network, on all of our shows. And I think we've gotten so much benefit and rub from that, and we've been really fortunate that these really, really big names have come to work with us. I would love to see in 2015 us, you know, create names, mm-hmm. and create comedic talent. And if we can be known for somebody, for, you know, creating somebody's career and putting them on the map, it would be fun to do that. In many ways, you know, that happened with Carrie Brownstein, mm-hmm. in the world of comedy, but she was, you know, she already was a personality in, you know, on the music scene for sure. So it was a little bit different. So it'd be nice to break talent and do that. Also, you know, our designs are to do more original programming. It would be nice to go into some other comedy formats. So what is our green screen kind of show where somebody's, you know, showing something and commenting, or a panel show? And what does that look like? You know, we had some success in sketch and moved on to narrative. Now what's the next thing in comedy for us? I think after 4 years, we should start exploring. It'd be nice to be able to, for somebody to peg one of those shows as something that they love and find successful.
So you have had, like you said, you have had some incredible names coming mm-hmm. to the network who could go anywhere, right? So
yeah.
What do you hear from them, you know, as far as why IFC right now at this moment?
They want to get rich. They want to make a lot of money working on our shows. Because, you know, movies.
She's not funny at all, right? You can't even imagine she runs a comedy network.
Yeah, I mean, we've built a reputation of being a good place for creatives. Again, they're not coming. Kristen Wiig is doing perfectly fine on her own, and Will Ferrell, and they don't need to necessarily work with us, but they want to. They want to. You know, the times that I get the exposure to these people before we start to do projects with them, they comment about, we like what you're doing. We think what you're doing is really interesting, and we'd like to be a part of it. Or we have a project, and we know it can't go anywhere else but here. Or, you know, just by design, it's kind of this really interesting matrix of talent that it's like a 6 degrees of separation game, you know?
We're
doing,
one and
yeah, I mean, we've now had 5 successful seasons of Portlandia. We produce it with Lorne Michaels and Broadway Video and Fred Armisen, and now we're doing a show that'll premiere on the network next year with Fred Armisen and Seth Meyers and Bill Hader. I mean, it's like a dream team for us. Will Ferrell is attached to a project that Funny or Die brings to us. Kristen Wiig wants to work. And so you see how it, yeah. You know, David Cross has done other shows with us. We say, will you guest star on Marin? Yes. And he also comes back to us 3 years later and says, I want to do another season of The Increasingly Poor Decisions of Todd Margaret. What do you think? You know, and he certainly is a very busy man. So the experience, I think, is a great part of that.
You know, you can look at numbers and see there are, you know, YouTube stars, digital channel stars that have millions and millions and millions of views, and they become these big stars. But I keep hearing, and maybe this is, you know, the people working in TV want to believe this is still the case, or maybe it is the case, but that still people want to be on television. Mm-hmm. There's something very still special and different about being on television versus being on the internet. Mm-hmm. What's your take on that?
Is that a pull? I think there's something very sexy about having a television show, you know, a half hour, 1 hour, whatever it is, show. A platform that's regular, and there's something very traditional about it. There's no, it's very clear that YouTube channels and the multi-channel universe in the digital space is a phenomenon. It's very interesting to see what gains traction and what doesn't. I watch my 9-year-old watch YouTube videos of people playing video games, and I still don't understand why, but he does it, and he does it for hours.
And a lot of people do that.
This is what he does, but I'm sure, you know, Mario Kart Dad, who has, you know, his channel on YouTube because he does this thing, I'm sure he'd love a TV show.
Right.
So I do think there is something still very sexy about it. Now, will someone with all of those views and fan base, will the show work for TV? You know, that is not a guarantee.
Yeah.
But certainly the YouTube stars has become quite a sensation, and it's fascinating.
So let's talk a little bit, switch back to the big name people. Spoils of Babylon is one that's got some big names in it. How did that all come together? And
I was actually at that pitch. I'm at very few initial pitches, and I was actually present for that pitch. And the folks at Funny or Die did come to us and say, we have this thing. We don't think we can take it anywhere but IFC. And they explain that there's this fictional author, his name is Eric John Rosch. We think it will be played by Will Ferrell. He thinks this is a very cool project. And he's created a number of works. This one's called The Spoils of Babylon. And we're gonna turn it into a miniseries. And they take this gigantic book, like think like Thornbirds back in the day, you know, when people were on the beach reading their big gigantic hardcovers that are this thick, and they take this book and kind of plop it on the table, makes a big thud, and they had it all mocked up with the author on the back and the cover, and they had it all thought out. You know, it's a mini series, it's a mini series event, it's a throwback to what mini series were.
So really, actually again. Started from this digital world, and
yeah.
They wanted to do
they
television.
They wanted to do it in television, and you know, we left the pitch and said, we're gonna, you know, let's go straight to series on this. They promised us incredible names because of Will's attachment to the project and the, you know, his ability to get talent. And sure enough, we had Kristen Wiig and Tobey Maguire and Jessica Alba and Haley Joel Osment and Tim Robbins and, you know, a list of guest stars, and it was quite incredible. It was very over the top. It was, it's like the ultimate spoof, but so in the vein of what Funny or Die does well.
And we have an example of that too.
Yeah, this was a trailer that we released as a teaser to season one. Season two is coming back. It's based on a new book or one of the. From the library of Eric John Rosch, who Eric John Rosch was played by Will Ferrell in the show. It's called The Spoils Before Dying, but this was from Spoils of Babylon. Yeah. A self-indulgent, over-the-top, over-dramatic comedy. Doesn't that make sense? And Kristen Wiig got nominated for an Emmy for Outstanding Actress in a miniseries, the only comedic actress. I was like, do they know? It's not real. But she's phenomenal.
That's fantastic. So, you know, when we were first talking about the tagline, you said, you know, the alternate being the shit you can't find anywhere else on TV. And you really can't find that anywhere else, right? And just like you said, Funny or Die, they said, this is it's only IFC. Who do you consider your biggest competition, though?
It's everywhere. I can't pinpoint one. I mean, the obvious answer would be other cable channels that do comedy. But it's so much more than that now. It's, you know, those in the digital space, people that we'd love to partner with, make their own content. It's, you know, streaming services. It's everyone. You know, there's phenomenon that take off that are, you know, self-user generated. It really truly is everywhere, which makes it so rich and interesting, and it does give and present a lot of opportunity, but it also, you know, presents challenges because you have to move quickly and you have to make your place, your network, your brand, where people want to work, have a unique proposition that really draws them in and makes them, you know, makes them want to share their work with you and form a relationship and partnership. So it's a great time because there's so much choice out there, but the competition is, it's fierce and it's everywhere, truly. It's not just, you know, oh, these three, gotta watch them.
I think I know the answer to this, given your background as a marketer and your, you know, just being a marketer at heart. But with this, increasing number of choices and sources for entertainment and comedy, is it going to be more, less, or the same amount of importance to have a strong brand?
You know, there's... I think today it's actually rare for people to say, I love that channel. Everything that channel shows is for me. It's more about I love that show, right? I love that show. It's my favorite show. Have you watched this show? For a network like ours, who, you know, the size of our channel, one that is relatively new to a genre and a position, I think the brand is actually incredibly important. And I believe we get credit for being that brand and living it 24/7, whether we're showing Portlandia, Marin Comedy Bang Bang, or a movie or an acquisition. I do think we get credit for that. And I do think it plays great importance as to who we are, and that's unique. I wouldn't say that holds true for every network. And we try to present ourselves with this edge and with this attitude. And I do think it really comes through in everything that we do outside of the programming.
I see it's time for us to go to Q&A. Would it, we do have one more clip that's real brief, is that okay? It's really to your point, Jen, about infusing the brand through everything, and you mentioned movies. You know, there still are library.
Yeah, there's still movies on the network. They're not always comedies. They do have to fit into the sensibility of slightly off. So, but how do you... You know, how do you market that movie when you're going to tell people that it's on and you should come watch it on IFC in a way that fits into the brand so you're not kind of falling out of the experience and then going back in? So I think we have two examples of just promoting our film in a slightly off way. I want all of Scarface with a laugh track.
Yeah. We'll put that on the list for 2015,
It's like too. A drinking game.
Yeah. Well, I think we have a good amount of time for questions. I'm sure many of you have them. If you do, stand up, wave. We'll get a microphone over to you.
I don't know if I could find you. Stand up and wave.
Well, you don't have to give them your microphone. Good.
Thanks. So with existing shows like Comedy Bang Bang and or Marin that had sort of lives of their own as podcasts before they became TV shows, and two examples of shows that are not totally similar to, or may not have worked in their current incarnation as TV shows, could you talk about the transition from the success they had as podcasts and to how they had to change and develop to become mm-hmm. things that worked on television, and the involvement that you guys had with some sort of strong creative voices in those yeah. instances?
Well, with Scott Aukerman and Comedy Bang Bang, it was, we went to Scott and said, if you can do this podcast as a TV show, what would it look like? And it was, the concept itself seems relatively easy because you're like, just plop it into a television format. But it needed to be thought through. It's not a talk show. It's completely scripted. It's a spoof of a talk show. He has real, credible guests on. He had Kevin Smith on last week. He has Amy Poehler. He has Zach Galifianakis. He's big names. They're sitting down on a couch next to him, and it's like nonsense questions that he's asking. I mean, he's the guy who produces Between Two Ferns. So if you could think along, that in that vein. So that was actually a little bit more difficult. I just think in terms of the how do we do this so we truly make it into a compelling television show, because it's very wacky and it's certainly off the wall. Marin, I think the harder part about that was having conversations with Mark. Again, the podcast is just, that's his work, that's his job, and the show's about, people who come in and he conducts the podcast, and there's all these other things that happen in his life. The harder part about that was, he's so close to it. It's so personal to him that, I had conversations with him about, I've revealed this to my audience already on my podcast, and I feel like, we've told them, and it's like, let's remove ourselves from the podcast time and let's put ourselves in TV time. And yeah, we know that this is, we know that, you had a breakup, and they know, and your audience knows this and cares about that. What would that look like in a, in a fictional setting? So that's been kind of, the more interesting way that podcast has played out in that way. He is a very, very close and deep relationship with his fan base and cares very much about them and is very protective of them.
Another question?
Thanks.
Here. Hi, Diane.
What shows on other networks have you seen that you would love for your channel?
There are shows that happen to be shows that I personally love. I love The League. I think that's a fantastic show. Always Sunny in Philadelphia. I wish those shows were on IFC. Amy Schumer, she's an incredible talent. At Midnight, love the format of that show as well. I love Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I think Andy Samberg's awesome.
At Midnight?
Clearly, I have a long list of shows that I want.
Yeah, my nephew.
That's not currently on.
Time to watch all of that.
Are
you thinking late night? You mentioned At Midnight, like the format.
Yeah, I think for At Midnight, it's more of the format. I think the midnight thing for them, it makes perfect sense, or they transition from Daily Show and Colbert into that. Late night works incredibly well for us. We have a strong audience late night, so that's not out of the question. Comedy Bang Bang airs at 11 p.m. on Fridays. That's where it's worked best, but not so much geared toward a late night show, but more what's a showcase for talent. What's a show kind of a panel show look like on IFC?
We got some more questions.
Hey, girl.
Hi.
I want to know, what was your professional background? Like, where'd you go to school? How did you get your professional start? Where were you before IFC?
I was a dancer. I went to the High School of Performing Arts in New York City. And I thought that I was going to go to an art school. I applied all over the map, and I thought, well, I'm going to go to NYU, and I'm going to be a dance major. I'm going to be on Broadway, and that's what's going to happen. And the day I graduated high school, I came to the realization that I was just way too short to be a dancer. I had too many curves. I couldn't sing. What the fuck was I thinking? I can't make any money. Like, what are the chances of me actually being able to make money doing this? To boot, I completely messed up my audition for NYU, didn't get in, was completely heartbroken. So I went to Hunter College in New York City and said, if I want to decide to audition again and make a go of this, I can do that, or I can just figure out what I want to do and I'll transfer. And I wound up taking, and I said, so what's my backup plan? Because I always thought I would be a dancer. And I thought to myself, well, the only other thing I like besides that is music, and I'm not going to join a rock band, and television. So I started taking media classes my freshman year, and I fell in love, decided not to transfer, and stayed, and desperately wanted to get into cable. Cable television was my favorite, the business of cable television was my favorite class. Couldn't get into cable immediately when I graduated, so I started in radio, which was fine, you know, but it wasn't what I wanted to be. And my first job in cable was at Food Network. And I started there, and then I went to Oxygen when it was launching. Then I went to Court TV before it was True TV. Found my way to IFC.
Fantastic.
Thank you. I have a 2 or 3-tiered question for both of you. Since
it's not allowed.
It's not allowed, but it pertains to you.
She's taking time.
I only ask questions.
She's doing things for you, though, which I'm assuming
she does. And very
good
at it, by the way.
Excellent.
You make it easy. Thank you.
As, correct me if I'm wrong, the senior editor for broadcast and cable?
Editor-in-chief.
And editor-in-chief.
Excuse me.
I wanted to qualify.
She's president, though.
Different entities. However, because of all the changes with IFC, how have you promoted the change in your programming? And because you haven't changed the name, and has your publication helped to promote and identify the changes that have taken place? And have you advised the public as to the change in the demos, which I'm sure they have, and what are they? I would like to know that, and the difference in the demos at IFC originally and now, and what your average rating is now, and what your goals are to be within your 5-year plan. It's wonderful what you're doing, but it's interesting to me to find out what you've done to promote the network. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I'm sure since you are friends and associates, that you have been involved with helping to promote the changes in the network.
Can you start that again? I'm sorry.
I said it was 3-tiered.
No. Do you want me to go first, or do you want to go first?
You go ahead.
It's funny, because we actually did change the name. Which, of course, that makes absolutely no sense based on everything I've said today, but we were officially Independent Film Channel LLC, and we put a press release out, I think it was during one of the television critics tours, I think it was last year, actually, it was 2 years ago. I was so sick and tired of seeing Independent Film Channel on things, I would have a fit every time I did. So people in our press department, somebody who's here, they said, let's put out a release. So we legally and officially changed the name just to IFC and put out a release saying, there's nothing to say except for Independent Film Channel is no longer, IFC is now IFC. It stands for absolutely nothing except IFC. And we're very humorous about it. It actually got picked up in a lot of places. The Associated Press, I sat down with Associated Press and with other publications immediately and talked about it. And it caught on and it got a lot of pickup. And I think it was, you know, probably the most deliberate way to say, stop calling us that.
And very on brand, too.
Yeah.
You know, that's
it was completely,
the approach was
I'm doing it no justice. It was actually, if you go look it up online, it was actually a very funny release. And my statement was like, I have absolutely nothing to say other than we're IFC now. It stands for absolutely nothing.
And we don't see releases like that so much. So that does stand out. To answer your question, as far as promoting it, I would probably just use a different word, which would be to cover it. But, you know, my job on the editorial side is to cover and analyze and help make sense or raise questions that we should all be thinking about in the business of television. On the ad sales side, yes, hopefully they do plenty of promotion by buying ads on the ad side. And I'm sure that they have. That's not my area, as they say. That would be my boss, the publisher's. Stuff. But yes, absolutely. We've been following this, as you can hopefully tell. I'm very familiar with what Jen's been doing in her career. And, you know, she's somebody who I've followed as a journalist covering the TV business for a long time and been very inspired by. So it's been an absolute pleasure and privilege to get to talk with you this evening. So
thank you. So, yeah, so we're actually... people didn't realize we were as young as we were and that we were skewing male. So we played right into that and went aggressively at an adult 18 to 49 audience that is a 70% male audience.
Did we get them all?
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Great questions. Do we have a question? Oh, yeah.
How did you get connected with the Paley Center and who brought this together tonight? I mean,
That's a great question. Renee, can I?
Right over there. Renee.
Thank you, Renee. I'm a member, and I love what they do here, and I will tell you that this does spread the word. People here are passionate about television, and everything that I've followed, it's because I've come here first.
Oh, that's so great.
We don't have time to see everything, so when you come here, I go, okay, they picked the things I should know about.
They're a great organization. They're great partners.
Absolutely. So thank you for being here. Well,
thanks for having me.
So well put. And thank you for your words. And it's actually time for us to thank you all for being here. And thank you, Jen.
Thank you for coming. Thank you.